Well, I don't know. Partly, I was looking for a little tension in the book, that things were not going to go smoothly. Again, a lot of these things, I would sit down and say, what is going to happen in this chapter? And I would just start to write, and things happened. And I tell you honestly that I didn't plan them. A lot of these characters, they just turned up, and there they were, full-blown characters. And I just let them talk and do and carry on. So I did not really figure out, oh, I'm going to have him buy a restaurant and he can't keep it. That happened. And I write very much from my subconscious.
And then on the other side, Larry, who was with the Black family, when his mother or the adopted mother dies, the brother says, I'm not related to you. You're just taking up space. Get money, do this. And fortunately, there's a musician teacher at the school who takes him under his wing.
Yes. Yes, well, again, each of these boys grows up not with a not comfortable, happy childhood.
Yeah. But you end with the meeting at a contest of high school musicians, and someone thinks they've seen who, where, and it's a fact the boys are identical.
Yes, yes.
And one hopes they will have a happy life.
Yeah, I rather think they will, because, you know, the character of these boys, they were patient, they were nice, they were thoughtful, they were a little shy, they didn't easily make friends, but they wanted friends, they were lovable, they wanted to love. I think they were really nice people, and I think finding one another would really be a blessing for them.
Yeah. Claire, what brought you into music?
Well, I think dancing. when I was young, what we did was go dancing. Boy took you out and you went to a ballroom. We had ballrooms all over the place. Los Angeles must have had 14 ballrooms along the coast. Every single seaside place had a pier. Every pier had a ballroom. Every ballroom had a band. And we went dancing. So there was a considerable difference between what we used to call the Mickey Mouse bands, which didn't have very much rhythm, and the really good jazz bands. And so as soon as I found that out, because, you know, I was a jitterbug, I loved to dance.
When were you born? What year?
Because 1919.
So you are 92.
Almost.
Almost 92.
Yes.
That was quite an era then that had all those ballrooms.
And all those bands.
Yeah.
Hundreds of bands traveled all over the United States in the band bus, on the train, back and forth from one city to another. Yes, it was a very, very different time.
Then where did you go from there within music, other than dancing on Saturday night?
Yeah. Well, after I graduated from college, I was supposed to have been a social worker, but I discovered that poor people made me very uncomfortable, and I just felt just uneasy that I had and they didn't. I just felt, this is not something I'm going to do. I really want to do something in music, and I wound up working in a record shop, which was partly mine.
Mm-hmm.
And then I'm still going out listening to music, meeting musicians. It just, one thing just sort of led to another.
And then,
shall I tell you about working for Duke Ellington?
Yes,
is that what you're leading
up
to?
Yes, I would like to, and I'm going to hold up a picture of Duke Ellington that is in this fabulous book by Herman Leonard called Jazz. And I guess this is what you remember. But this is Duke Ellington in France, in Paris.
Yes.
Did you travel with him at all?
No. The band actually traveled on their own train during the years I was with the band, and there were not really facilities for an extra woman to travel. The married couples, you know, adjusted to this, but a single woman just did not fit into that picture. Mm-hmm. So while I sometimes would take a train separately to be with the band, I did not travel with the band.
Mm-hmm.
And you know, I did not meet Leonard. Everybody's asked me, did I meet him? No, our paths just did not cross. I think he was maybe a year or two younger than I. We weren't at the same place at the same time, but we knew all the same people.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And how did you happen to have Unforgettable as a song you were related to?
Right. Well, I married a songwriter. He wrote hundreds of songs. Unforgettable is one of them. What he used to do was to write 8 or 10 songs, have a record made of them, to take a piece of sheet music, take the plane to New York. We lived in Los Angeles, and go around from one publisher to the next to get them to give an advance on the song, and then after that they would get record coverage and get people to sing it or make mm-hmm. a band play it. And so that was what would be the next step. Well, this one song, finally, nobody wanted it. And there's a pretty good reason. It went out of key in the bridge, in the middle section. And all our friends, songwriters, used to tell my husband, Irving Gordon, you can't do that, Irving. You go out of key there. And he said, well, it gets back. I go, da-da-da-da-da. And he said, well, I don't know how else to make the song go. Well, anyway, there was a publisher who took anything. And so I said, why don't you stick him with the song? So he said, all right. So he stuck him with the song. And months went by, and nobody recorded it. Same reason. So I said, you know what, I'll call Nat Cole, and I'll ask him if he'll record it.
How did you know him?
Ah, well, I knew Nat when he was nobody. He was playing in a little shabby place on La Brea near Beverly Boulevard called the Swanee Inn that seated maybe 30 people. We had a little trio.
Yeah.
And he was wonderful, and I used to go every night and drag my boyfriends and drag everybody I knew, and Nat and I were friends from that day on, and because I really, oh, I not